you very much, John, for having a chat with me today. I really appreciate it. And just to start off, I'd like you to tell me a little bit about yourself and how you got into beads, if that's okay.
Yeah, no problem. I work in a factory. I'm a maintenance technician in the place they used to make Blu-ray, DVD and compact discs. I got into beads about 15 years ago. People ask me regularly how I got into them. I don't really know. I think I just got interested in bees and how they live or how do they live, and it just started, you know, following people on the internet and things, and just had a general interest. And then I joined the Fingal North Dublin Beekeepers Association. I did the introduction course there, and about a year later I had my own hive and grew from there. I'm still in Fingal Beekeepers. We had a first meeting in nearly 2 years last Thursday, which was good. It was a honey tasting evening.
Nice.
I became interested in AMM. Mainly, I saw these little snippets of ads going up about open days in apiaries with this crowd called Nibs, I didn't know who it was, but one of them was in Nace, and I live in Rush County, Dublin, so Nace is not too far, and I says, oh, I'll go down there Sunday morning and see what this is all about. And it just blew me away. I'd been around, you know, bees and our own association, Apri, and different things for a long time, and kind of thought I'd nearly learned everything there was till I went to this open day, Nibs open day, and the way they did it was they had a different sections, so different people who knew the different things about, so for example, just frames or, you know, grafting queens or how to use an apidea. So each table had a different theme, and you just went around, and I was just amazed by how much knowledge these people had, and it kind of brought me into a part of beekeeping I never knew about. I didn't know you could go near a beehive without gloves, for instance. I went to quite a lot of those. John Somerville's being another one, that's in Tullamore. And John was opening beehives, and you could just run your hand along the top of the hive with no glove. No bees came to attack you. I just couldn't believe these bees.
Nice docile colonies then.
Beautiful colonies. And as you probably know from his record, of, I think they made it a special award because he was the first Irish person to win 10 gold medals in a row or something in London.
Yeah,
so
amazing.
He's not just breeding docile bees, he's breeding amazing bees that win all these prizes. So
you been into bees at this point when you went along to the Nibs thing?
Probably about 4 or 5 years, I'd say. Yeah. I do tend to get very involved in things, and I did say I'm not going to get really involved in this now. I'm just going to watch. I have been in things before, and I'd been on committees, and I said, never again. I'm finished with all that. I'm never going to be on a committee. It's because I didn't want to get too involved, because I tend to get over involved in things sometimes. So I did go to the open days for Nibs and that, and they do some great leaflets, and they actually have a book out now. So I did buy the leaflets, but I never, most people are suited up at the open days, so you might meet 30 people, but you wouldn't necessarily know who they are if you met them in a supermarket, because they have a black net in front of their face. Now, we normally had tea and sandwiches afterwards, but again, I would have been just turning up on my own. I obviously would know John Somerville and Colm O'Neill and that, who ran the open days now, but I still couldn't tell you who was at all of the open days it was at, but they probably wouldn't recognize me either. But
it's easy enough to get sucked into something though when you're interested in it, and
yeah, no,
you end up doing jobs. I know myself. I'm the same.
Well, I'm the librarian in Fingal Beekeepers, and I did say I'd do that, and then someone rang me and asked me, was I okay for the committee meeting on Thursday? And I says, well, no, I'm not on the committee. I've never volunteered for that. And they said, no, once you're the librarian, you're on the committee. So I was
that was it.
I was trapped into that one. So, and I still am the librarian. So unfortunately, last Thursday, to bring about 200 books to the meeting, but it was terrible that people didn't have a chance to get them during the lockdown thing.
Yeah,
I did. I joined a website called Livid, which you can put all the books up on. You know, it gives a summary of what the books are about and everything. So hopefully people could access that, and I could say drop the book out to them somehow or other. It didn't really work during lockdown though. But quite a few people went for the books now last week, thankfully. So we've got a few out there. We've got some books going back to, like, I don't know, very early 1900s. So it's a bit of a responsibility to look after them as well. I joined NIHBS then, and again, you know, just got kind of drawn into the committee situation there as well. Now,
and how did the Queen Rearm program that's on at the moment, did that end up coming about? You know,
it's not on now, it's just finished for the moment. So
yeah,
basically it came about because of, we're all aware that there's times when you need a queen and you can't get one.
Absolutely.
Basically, there seemed to be more of what we would call the non-native bees than the native ones being available. So, sorry, I just need to take a drink. If obviously we know how it feels when you need a queen in a hurry, and if you're ringing up to try and get a native Irish queen, you can't get one, and then some guy says, oh, I have as many as you want, they're only €30, they're a different breed, you're going to want to save your hive or whatever, so people are going to go and buy them. So we did it to counteract that happening, to give more native Irish queen bees out there to people, but also to teach people how to do it. That was the big thing we did. So the idea is, we know everyone who signed up for the program won't keep going and some will drop out. It's the same with anything. We had a Zoom, it was all done on Zoom, which worked out very well because the amount of people who actually did turn up, you know, I don't know where we would have actually rented it. And also, because it was nationwide, it was great. So you could have someone from Cork, someone from Donegal, someone from Dublin, people from Antrim, say, but not having to all get in the cars and drive for 3 miles. So in this year, in 2021, we set up 13 groups. Now, we basically sent out emails to all the the associations around the country. So say like Fingal, South Kildare, North Kildare, all the different groups around, and I know some secretaries or PROs or whatever would be better than others. So you may have, say, like, I don't know, say someone from Carlo Beekeeper saying, I never heard of this before, you know, but unfortunately we just have the amount of people to send out to that we have on our list, and that's it. Some people are better at communicating stuff than others. We did put an ad, I think, in about care, I'm fairly sure, to say about it. I can't swear to that, but I know there was publicity done. I'm not in charge of it or anything, but we did try and get the message out there. Now, of the 13 groups we got, if we got, say, 130 groups, we couldn't have handled that. So with the 13 groups, we started off Zoom meetings with them, and there was normally 140 people. I think we'd 180 could have potentially been there. Yeah, I think we went up to 176 one night, but it was normally about 140 people. So that ran over, I think, about 18 weeks. And each week was, we had Colm O'Neill and Jonathan Getty. They were like the teachers, and they had slideshows set up and explained everything. So we went through everything to do with cream rearing. So you could do splits, grafting, using Genta kits, everything. So you could, some people, like in our own case, in my group that we set up, we tried doing the Genta kit and you know, the whole different range that we were taught, but we tended to just use, we found the Genta kit worked and that's what we used. People could, you know, say just practice on the other things as well if they wanted. The idea was to get as many people involved in doing it, instead of, say, one person in the association just being the guy who makes the queens and no one knows how to do it otherwise, you know. Now, yeah, we did do our practical work while, you know, it was fairly well locked down. So as in going out, we made double brew chambers, we had to make drone frames. we had to set up 60 apidaeas, all that. You know, we had to go do somewhere. Now, there was about six of us did it. I didn't attend all of them, but there was been three or four people who did, and, you know, kind of put all the work in. But a lot of it was just to do with distancing and everything as well. Next year, hopefully, if these figures come down, there could be potentially 20 or 30 people come to those.
Yeah.
You know,
and events. It's my understanding that it's kind of a program that spans over 2 years or so before you really see any results, because of the, it's all about, well, the drones. And
after our latest meeting, we've said 3 years.
Yeah.
So, for example, what we did in Fingal, we went around, or one of our members was gracious enough to go around all the beekeepers in Hove, and we did three areas, but Hove was the one that came back to us as being the biggest black bee area we could find without any hybridized bees there. All of those beekeepers accepted some frames with a brood foundation. So they, sorry for drones, they put them in all the hives for us. So basically they made loads of drones. So we kind of flooded Howth with Irish black bee drones. So what we did then was, as our queens were coming out, which was in a kind of a building that the council had lent to us, because we used an incubator for the final, you know, for the queens to emerge. So we got all the queens and we brought them up to apidaeas in Howth, where there was another kindly person give us a site. So our idea was that, you know, we'd have all these apidaeas in this peninsula full of Irish black bee drones, so the queen should be, you know, mated with those drones. Also, sorry, NIHBS gave us the original queens to breed from good apiaries, the likes of Colm O'Neill or John Somerville. So we knew where the queens came from, and we have a reasonably good idea that we were getting black drones. There was a fire on hold for weeks. That affected a lot of the beekeepers in Hoth with their honey crops and all that type of stuff. It didn't seem to affect our breeding, because the very first inspection we had, it was fantastic. We had like 80% success of mated queens. And the way we did it was then that those queens came out and then we put new queens in, you know, as they came out of our incubator. So we had like four shots of that. And then, now, some people would have kept going. We stopped after the four, mainly just people didn't, you know, the amount of time involved is incredible. Until you, and that was with six of us. I don't know how people do it just with one or two. You do need help. There's a lot of work in it, especially if you've 60 to 80 happy days going. And we had 13 groups around the country. So they had mixed results, some very good, some kind of middling, but we got, just let's see, I actually wrote it down here. I think we got an average of 8 queens for everyone who was involved. So, for example, the 6 in our group, there was, we got about 100 and some, I think we got 180 queens, but we just kind of averaged it out between the people. Overall, I think our overall result was about 160 queens that were raised.
It's pretty good for the first year as well.
Now, what we hope to do next year is to produce a lot of nukes, maybe 3-frame nukes, as well as queens. The problem being, when we knew we had queens that were obviously, we could see we had got queen cells. So we had, say, 40 queen cells, and we're putting them into the apidae. So, or not into the apidae, into the, I keep calling them egg incubators, because you can use them for chickens.
For chickens, yeah.
Into the incubator. It was then to know that we had people, once these were mated and ready to go, obviously you don't have a few weeks to wait, you know, to give them to people. So a lot of them went to the people in Hoth who helped us and members who needed them. But if we go with the new group, you know, you have more time, especially if someone rings. So if someone rang us up 2 weeks after we'd done the last lot of queens, we were going, yes, it was the same old story kind of thing. Yeah, no, we don't have any. And they're going, but you just ran a queen rearing thing. So we're hoping to do more nukes so that obviously the queen can sit there for longer and be looked after, and we'll have more time to give people.
Yeah, that makes sense, because it is a very specific time frame when you're going from craft to actually having a queen ready to go, isn't it?
And to be honest with you, now obviously the people who were running, Colm and that, who were actually teaching us, it wasn't a learning curve for them as such, but it was for the rest of us. So
yeah,
we learned an awful lot.
I actually attended it. I have to say that the knowledge that those men have and how freely they shared their knowledge and their expertise was unbelievable. You know, people I'm sure in other countries or around the world would pay dearly for yeah. such a privilege.
Well, that was the other thing, was that it was free. So it was brilliant. And like, there wasn't a question they were asked, I think they didn't know the answer to, you know?
Yeah, I found that. And would you say there was any major challenges with the programme, say, aside from the timing out of, like, getting the Queens out to people as a specific
Yes, at the very start, our timetable didn't go as we predicted. So, March, April, I think we told everyone they would have the nuke with the Queen, say, at the end of April. But it turned out to be the middle of May. So there was things like that that happened to us, but it was just the people who were supplying them. You know, that's when they had them. So unfortunately, people were ready to go. They had all the stuff and they said, right, where's our Queens? You know, the original Queen to start off with. And there was a bit of a delay there for some people, but there was nothing really major.
Yeah, that was probably, the bees have their own ideas, I suppose.
That's the thing, yeah.
One thing I was wondering about, you mentioned it earlier about the hybrids. Is that as big a problem in Ireland, or is it kind of overstated, would you say? The hybridization and the way people say that they get a bit wicked if they crossbreed with them.
Probably a bit of both.
Yeah.
So the other peninsula we were looking at, I won't name it, we knew we had 60 to 70 native Irish black bee hives there. When we checked it out, we found one field. I don't know if the person is a beekeeper or keeps everything. They seem to have pigs, vegetables, various types of animals, and 200 non-Irish bees, 200 hives sitting in this field. So that totally destroyed that area on us. Now, 3 years before that, that hadn't been there. So this person had moved in, got all these bees and banged them all on this peninsula, totally destroying the native Irish bees that were there. So the people who have bees there are starting to notice, you know, little yellow stripes coming onto the bees and all that type of stuff from the breeding that's going on.
Would they have noticed like a change in the temperament of those colonies now, or is it kind of just the appearance of them?
Yeah, a lot of them found in especially in year two that they'd start being quite nasty, you know. You know, the people one guy had his bees for 30 years and all of a sudden he was having to make sure there wasn't any holes at all in his suit and make sure he had his gloves on every time, where he was going gloveless before that, you know. So it tends to be people who aren't like in, say, FIBGA or in an association or anything as well. So these people just appear and just get bees. Now, it's not necessarily that they're trying to do anything wrong or saying, here, I'm going to, you know, mess with all the beekeepers around here. They mightn't even know there is other beekeepers there.
Yeah.
They're just people who move in and just buy these bees off the internet, and it's a nice quick sale. Oh, they're nice and cheap, and start off with all these bees. But we do find that they're not in, like in my association, you know, we've a lot of members, and we would try and track down, right, who's got bees in such a place to try and find the owner. And everyone's like, not me, I don't live there, you know. So we had one, a man rang us up. There was a gate beside a lane, and he said he could see lots of bees, and but they just seemed to be coming from bushes. So Fingal County Council and two or three of the members of our association went in. We had to find out who owned the land before we went in. Fingal County Council owned it. They gave us permission to go in the gate. So the guys stripped back all the hedges and found loads and loads of beehives. Now, I've seen the pictures, and I don't have them to show you. And it appears whoever did it, whoever set the bees up, it was quite well done. You know, it wasn't, it was a mess now, but when they originally did it, it was okay. But the guys checked out the bees. There'd been rats and mice and everything through the hives because they're all overgrown at this stage. They were full of AFB. And the council actually got in a digger. They cleared the whole place. They dug a huge pit and everything was burned. And Mary Coffey was sent samples and everything, and it was AFB. We don't know who the beekeeper is. We don't know if it's someone who maybe passed away or something, because it was very well set up. But there's things like that. The guy who spotted it had beehives up the road, so he had to get all his checked out for American fowl brood then, you know?
Yeah.
Well, the pictures that I saw were horrendous of what had happened to this place. But
such a shame.
Yeah, and like if the guy had been in an association, maybe someone would have looked at, you know, come and helped him or looked after them if he was ill or whatever. But to this day, no one, not Fingal, don't even know who it is.
Yeah.
Even though it was on their land, you know. So it's things like that that we're trying to help people with, or, you know.
Yeah, I guess when you've no regulation on something, you're going to have issues like that. You know, it's the same the country over, really, isn't it?
Yeah. Now, I think it's Sweden or Denmark, I'm not too sure. They actually have bee inspectors, and you can't have a beehive unless this guy comes and checks your size. And I think he comes once a month to check your bees and all this. Personally, I don't know if we want to go down that road. You know, maybe it's a bit too over, because that guy works for the government there.
Yeah.
But it is a pity that things like that happen, because this was a lovely apiary. Like when all the hedging was cut back, the hives were all good. You know, they were well-built hives, well laid out. You know, the guy wasn't just chancing his arm, whoever he was.
Yeah.
No one knows who it was, though. So, no, he obviously didn't just leave it there. There was a lot of hives there.
Just something happened, yeah.
Something happened there somewhere, yeah.
And tell me, the AMM, our native bee,
yeah.
They're obviously adapted over time to our climate in Ireland. Now, yeah. Would you say, is climate change affecting the suitability of AMM, or are they adapting along with climate change, or have you got an opinion on it?
Well, obviously, so we're calling them, you know, AMM and their native Irish bee, but they did come up from Africa.
Yeah.
With the Ice Age and everything, they weren't, you know, St. Patrick didn't bless bees to be just Irish or anything. You know, they have evolved up, coming up through Europe and then into Ireland. Our big thing is that Ireland is the last place in Europe that does have good AMM bees. They don't have it in England anymore. So if they do get wiped out here or overpopulated by other strains of bees, that's it. It's gone. And you might say, well, push yourself, what? But they are a good bee for this country. They have, you know, acclimatized to the weather. There has been climate change. I think they're slowly adjusting to it. But definitely, like beekeepers I speak to, and you probably remember Philip McCabe, like he was a brilliant talker on bees and how he got into them. Like the town he lived in, it was all the Protestant people in the town who had the bees, and he just happened to have a neighbor who got him into it, but he was probably the first Catholic in the town to have bees, you know, because it wasn't something they did. So, but back in, if you go back, say, I don't know, 40 years, 30 years, you just put a box at the bottom of the garden and got 150 pound of honey, you know. Obviously, yeah, that isn't the case now, you know. So it could be the climate. It could be also, I think, the farming methods we're using now, I think are probably the biggest factor in that. I'm not saying farmers don't have to make a living as well, but...
yeah, so it's more of an issue than climate change. It's more of an immediate issue anyway, yeah.
I think the pesticides and everything are, yeah, to be honest with you. And that's the big thing. In Fingal, we've stopped, most people have stopped using anything for, you know, this AP viral and all this type of stuff. Well, the majority of members have actually voted saying that they've stopped using it. And we've got a fairly good bee resistance now to the formed wing disease and everything. Some people have actually lost hives, but rather than treat, they've lost that hive so that their other hives are reasonably resistant. And that's probably the way we're going to have to go. But personally, myself, I'm the same. The worst thing I would use maybe would be, you know, a ground up sugar shake or something. But I haven't for the last 6 years anyway.
Right. Yeah.
And I don't have a high mite count, you know, but it's because also, you know, the people around me are doing the same. So that I know of, this is the thing. So really everyone needs to kind of work together, you know, to fight all this stuff, you know. And also at our meetings, then you'd find out how people are doing, and you know that every, you know, someone might bring up a, you know, oh, I had such a problem, and they tell you what they did or whatever, you know. So like when I started, I was told to use wire meshed floor. So all the hives are part of wire mesh floors. Now, then 2 years later, it was like, oh no, you have to use solid floor. So an awful lot of what I learned, unfortunately, some of the people have passed away, but I tended to go with the advice I got from very old beekeepers, people in their 80s. And I tried to sit with them at the meetings at the same table. So people would be brought in to give us talks, and other people would be up saying what they do about this, that, and the other. And they'd be nudging me saying, no, don't do that. That's rubbish. And I wrote most of this down, and I would always remember it. And it tended to work. The things that the really experienced beekeepers knew, and it isn't in books, that they would tend to be the things that worked in a practical situation, you know. Now, yeah. I still have some hives with wire mesh floors. I have the, like, a blank in as well. Mainly just so I can see if I do have any, just see what's dropping down onto the board. But I tend to buy solid floors now if I was making a hive.
Yeah,
it's all trial and error, a lot of it. This is where the experience of people comes in massively. Because, you know, anyone who just goes out and gets one or two hives, the learning curve is huge, you know. And that's the other thing. I think you need a few hives so that you can help one maybe that's, you know, going weak or whatever. But I think they are changing with the climate. Definitely, I've noticed, you know, even since I started doing it, the bees are, you know, they're stopping bringing in supplies a lot sooner than they used to. Now, I'm in a lot of WhatsApp groups, and people up to last week are sending me photographs of them bringing in ivy and all types of stuff, but they're in Wexford, you know. So I think that, unfortunately, and it's weird, the further north you go, even in our country, which is small, there is a huge difference, you know.
Yeah, there is, yeah.
I noticed it on the Zooms. We were having meetings at 7 o'clock, and our president is living in Mayo, and I'd be sitting in the pitch dark, and I'd be watching the sun going down on his Zoom call behind him. Now, I think the difference might be only 15 minutes or 12 minutes or something, but it was just so strange to see, you know, the sun only setting where he was, and I'm just sitting in the pitch dark, you know. So
that's something I only realized this year, actually. Is that,
yeah,
in the west of Ireland, it gets dark a bit later. I never noticed before. Yeah.
I just noticed it on the Zoom, and I was saying, "Is that the, have you got a light on there, or is that the sun?" I know, the sun's setting. I said, "Well, I'm sitting in the pitch dark," and then you're getting a lot of feedback from other people. So now he was going out to his bees after that meeting then, because he still had some daylight. I wasn't. It's pitch dark outside, you know. So obviously, my bees were back, you know.
Even on Facebook, you know, on the forums and that, I've noticed, big difference between, say, like, I'm a Carlo beekeeper. And in what you were saying about bees bringing in ivy in certain parts of the country, or big difference in what's flowering even in the southeast versus, say, even the northwest or whatever.
Definitely. You know,
it could be weeks, several weeks of a difference. Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. So just to kind of finish off then, for anyone who's reading this or watching this online, how could any beekeepers who are interested in becoming involved with the program get involved? Is it through their own secretary, or do they contact NIHBS directly? Or
Well, the easiest, they can contact us. People are contacting us. So my email is nibs.pro@gmail.com.
Yeah.
I think that's right, is it? Yeah.
Yeah.
So they can contact me. They can go onto our website, which is nibs.org, which we've just recently redone, and it's a lot better than it was. And we actually have all, you know, drop downs for queen rearing. When we redid it originally, this is only weeks ago now, it was really slow. Excruciatingly slow. Like, it was whatever was going on, it was to do with Black Knight or something, who were the hosts, no one really knew. We've changed the host. It's better now, just in case anyone who is reading this is going, "Oh, their website's rubbish, I'm not going on it anymore." It is better now.
So you've had a makeover.
Yeah, no, but it was after the makeover it went slow, unfortunately. Yeah, it was fast before that. No, maybe we had too many videos in, I'm not too sure.
Yeah, too much makeup.
Yeah. The website is probably the easiest, or if anyone just wants to send an email to me, and I will either answer or forward on to Alan, who is like leading all of this, who set it up. The whole objective of it is to get as many, like, if 1,000 people want to rear queens, brilliant, that's what we want. Now, next year we're going to have, so I'm just trying to find the pictures for you, we're going to have 15 to 20 per group, which will be up on what we had last year, and this is all because we're hoping you know, that we won't be locked down or anything, you know, that'll be, sorry, this thing keeps opening. and then I've got Gmail, my own account as well as.
Hopefully we'll be over and done with lockdown.
Yeah, and we can have, so hopefully 15 to 20 a group, and we're going to have 15 groups. So what we're hoping is that one or two people will be happy that their groups, they know now what they're doing, and then we can open it up, you know, for other people.
Yeah.
The slides that the guys did, you attended the...
Yeah, they were brilliant, yeah.
So we're hoping to be able to share them. And so it's just a matter of, you know, especially if you just want it to refresh, you can have a look at it, you know. The hoping being that we would have, say, 6 to 10 people within each association who can rear a queen and help out the people in that association, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to find the things we did here. Was there anything else you wanted to ask me this
morning? No, that's pretty much it. I'm just giving you a minute there to find what you're looking for. No, I think thanks a million. That was really interesting. And as I said, like, I know I had attended the program or been involved with the program this year. But I'd say because different members within each association would have heard now about it. And I think, you know, I can imagine that the interest in this will increase over time. Actually, the guy who took charge in our association, he was like the group leader.
Yeah.
He was great, Darrell. And he's done talks with our association, you know, just updating all members of our association about what's going on with the program and all. So, you know, just kind of spreading the interest, even though there was only a few of us actually involved in the program.
You see, this is the thing.
Publicly and to our association as well. So, and he's great. Yeah.
This is the thing. It's trying to get people like that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry, it's not letting me get... I'll tell you what I can do if you want. I'll send you, because I have pictures of a nice lineup of all our happy days. It's not letting me get out of my NIHBS account. I'm sorry.
That's all right. If you could email those to me.
Would that be okay?
Yeah, that's perfect. And it'd be good if I could use those in on Backer then as well. No problem at all.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. That's
brilliant.
All right, well, sure, we'll wrap it up then. So
thanks very much.
Thank you so much for having a chat with me. I really appreciate it.
Oh, do you say? I appreciate being asked. Thanks very much.
No worries. Right. Well, we'll cross paths again soon, I'm sure.
Yeah. If you want to do it again or find out about updates. Sorry, just to let you know what the time scale is. So it's November now. So we're doing nothing now.
Yeah.
December. Then January will be kind of kicking off again.
Yeah.
So we'll be seeing, you know, right, who wants to go into year two and all of that. So probably February then, hopefully start the education side of it again, you know.
So in the new year then, really, people would want to be kind of looking to
exactly. Cool. Because a lot of people think, oh yeah, it's spring, but not for this. So the learning in this is all, so you, by spring you're ready to go,
yeah, that makes sense.
So as long as our queen actually get to the people. So because what we did was we wanted to know, you know, everyone had to know they had a good queen to start with, you know.
Yeah. So yeah,
that was a thing. But we saw it as a huge success, and way more success than we actually anticipated, to be honest with you. And now it's not that you know, say there are people who sell a few other queens, it's not a thing of trying to, like, you know, get rid of them or anything. It's that people who do want AMM queens can get them.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. There's, I don't know, is there 199 or 99 other basically solitary, and bees are also native to this country. You know, it's, we're not just trying to wipe out all the other bees or anything. It's just the bees that people tend to keep in hives are AMM bees, and just so they can get queens. I personally also like bumblebees, and I'd love to have you know, help in keeping them going. Sunflowers won't pollinate with normal bees. They need the buzz from the bumblebee.
Yeah.
I have solitary houses, I suppose you could call it, set up. We're not just about the AMM, but we don't want people to have to buy in Carniolan bees and other ones from other countries that will hybridize into our bees, you know. But we're not just, if you know what I mean, trying to stick up for the one bee. We are, if you're going to put it into a hive, trying to help you to get a native Irish honeybee queen. That's what it's all about.
That makes sense.
I've had it myself. It's happened, you know, it's not that it's hearsay. I've been stuck. You know, I've needed queens in a hurry and no one could help me, you know. We're hoping that we're going to reverse that, that people will be crying out like, here, I've loads of queens, who wants one?
Yeah.
Hopefully that's the way it'll go, so.
Yeah, cool. Well, best of luck with the program, and thank you so much again. All right.
That's brilliant. Thank you.
Thanks, John. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.